I heard an old story.
Thank you for tuning in to the television ministry of Clay's Mill Baptist Church. Join us as we share our passion for soul winning, spiritual growth, and revival in our state and nation. And now, Pastor Jeff Fugit.
Well, good evening and welcome to the program tonight. Thank you so much for watching. I believe you're going to enjoy the music this evening, and I trust that the preaching will be a blessing to you as I preach about the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Simply a Bible message and telling you who our Savior, who our Lord Jesus Christ is. What a joy it is to be a child of God. What a joy it is to know in whom I have believed and am persuaded that He is able to keep that which I have committed unto Him. If you do not have a church to attend, we'd love to invite you to be with us in the morning. We will be under the big white tent right out here in the front part of our property here at 1220 Brannan Road. Sunday school will begin at 9:30. All of us will be under the tent except the teenagers, and they will be in the teen center. But we'll be under the tent at 9:30, and then at 10:30, the preaching service begins. Join us for an old-fashioned Bible preaching Sunday under the tent, Sunday morning, Sunday night, 10:30 a.m. Sunday morning, 6 p.m. on Sunday night. I'd love for you to come. You can sit under the tent. You can sit around the tent. You can sit in your car, and you can see what's going on from your car. But I'd love to have you come tomorrow and be present with us here at the Clay's Mill Baptist Church. Then starting on Monday night, special services every evening, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. You are going to enjoy this conference, and you are invited, you are encouraged to attend and bring anyone and everyone you want with you to the service each evening at 7 o'clock. Now, each morning we will have church beginning at 10 a.m. Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. There will be teaching sessions for pastors, church staff, and laymen that will begin at 9 a.m. This will include sessions for the bus ministry. This will include sessions about the teen ministry. This will include sessions about soul winning and many other activities and works in the local church. So at 9 a.m. is the teaching. The preaching begins at 10 a.m. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday morning. All of it under the big tent. Now, I don't know if you've seen the forecast for the next few days, but it is absolutely perfect in my opinion. About 74, 75 degrees in the daytime, 55 degrees at night, so we'll have great mornings and great evenings. The sides are up on the tent. We can control the heat and cool air quite a bit. There's a beautiful banner about America. There's lights under the tent. In fact, there is a very nice restroom trailer that has been delivered, and you will be able to have access to that. I'm talking about an old-fashioned first-class tent revival beginning Sunday morning right out here under the tent. Now, one of our main themes for the conference is to focus on the need of America. America needs revival, my friend. We need to see revival from the church house to our house, from the church house to the schoolhouse. Friend, when they took God, our Bible, and prayer out of our school system, it began a downward slide that continues today. We are almost at the point of anarchy in our nation, and friend, we need revival. This week's conference will emphasize that. I want you to come. I'll be preaching on Monday night with my good friend, Dr. Chuck Harding. Dr. Harding has a ministry in Washington, D.C., and you'll want to hear his timely sermon as he preaches in the 7 o'clock hour on Monday evening. On Tuesday evening, you will hear evangelist John Hamblin. You don't want to miss this great preacher from Canton, Michigan. Then on Wednesday night, you'll hear my good friend, Dr. John C., from in Maryland, Frederick, Maryland, and my, how the Lord is using him in that church. On Thursday night, you'll hear my brother, Chris Fugit, pastor of the Gospelite Baptist Church in Hazard, Kentucky. We'll have preachers from across the country that will be here Tuesday morning, Wednesday morning, Thursday morning. I'm not going to say it anymore, but I'd love for you to come. I want you to join us tomorrow. You'll be glad you did. Here at the Clay's Mill Baptist Church, 1220 Brannan Road. I want to say thank you to those that have given to the conference and the rental of the tent and all the expenses that we've had. If you've intended to give, but you have not given yet, we would appreciate you giving toward that. And I'm speaking to our church members and friends of our ministry. If you would like to mail a check, mail an offering to our church, you can do so and send that to 3000 Clay's Mill Road, Lexington, Kentucky, 40503. We're still getting our mail at our old address, though both addresses work. Here's a good song that's going to bless your heart. Right after the song, we'll get into the message this evening.
Three Hebrew boys were thrown into the fire because before the king they would not bow. But they said, "Listen, king, let it be known. We serve a living God, we're not alone." Well, I know my God can do it. To him there's nothing to it. I know he'll see it through his sweet victory. Well, even when storms are raging, he is the rock of ages. I know that he is able, mighty is he.
They marched around the walls of Jericho. They knew the walls would fall, God told him so.
Just like he worked for them, he's working now. My God will never change, he has great power.
Well,
I know my God can do it. To him there's nothing to it. I know he'll see through his sweet victory. Well, even when storms are raging, he is the rock of ages. I know that he is able, mighty is he.
Well,
I know my God can do it. To him there's nothing to it. I know he'll see it through his sweet victory. Well, even when storms are raging, he is the rock of ages. I know that he is able, mighty is he. I know that he is able, mighty is he.
I'm preaching tonight from the book of Hebrews in chapter 1. There was a day in our nation that we knew and recognized the person of the Lord Jesus Christ in a very personal and an intimate way. There was a day that the Lord Jesus was recognized by leaders, presidents, common people, rich and poor. He was recognized as King and Lord. Songs were written and song books and hymn books were printed and distributed across our nation to express the greatness and grandeur of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Sermons have been preached to magnify his glory and his splendor. Holidays and special events have been established to recognize not only the person of Christ, but the power of Christ as far as his resurrection, his birth, and the work of the Lord Jesus. However, in recent years, as we have kicked God, the Bible, and prayer out of our school system, we have lost contact with the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Many know him as a meme or as a figure of a movie produced by Hollywood. My dear friend, I'd like to preach tonight about who my Jesus is. I want to read to you from the beautiful book of the first chapter of Hebrews as the Bible talks about our lovely Lord Jesus. The Bible says in Hebrews 1 in verse number 1, God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto our fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. And again I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again when he bringeth in the firstborn into the world, he said, And let all the angels of God worship him. Dear friend, the Bible that I hold in my hand is a book about the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. The most important fact to know about Jesus is that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God, and God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, he gave Jesus, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. If I could speak to the entire world about the person of Jesus, these are the things that I would tell the world, and I preach to you tonight about the person of Christ. First of all, Jesus was born of a virgin. You say, preacher, that is an impossibility. It is not possible for man to be born of a woman that does not know or has not been conceived of mankind. But dear friend, according to the word of God, Jesus was born of a virgin. His birth was miraculous. His conception by the Holy Spirit was miraculous. But that is true of the person of Christ. Here's what the Bible says about the virgin birth of Christ as recorded in the book of Luke in chapter 1 and verse number 26. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How can this thing be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest it shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. You see, Jesus, though he humbled himself and took upon him the form of flesh, he took upon him the form of a servant, Jesus was born of a virgin. While it was a natural impossibility, it is a supernatural truth that Jesus was physically born, as the Bible says, of a virgin. Yes, a miracle. Yes, different than anyone else. Now, that's important to understand, because man that is born of man is a sinner. The Bible says, Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Had Joseph been the father of Jesus, Jesus would have been no better than Joseph, his father, or you and me. He would have been a sinner. But Jesus was not conceived of man. He was born of a spirit. He was born of a virgin, conceived of the Holy Spirit, and he was born a sinless man. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 1 and verse number 18, now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, whereas his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. There are many that have claimed to be a Savior. They've claimed to be the Christ. But that individual, though they may have lived a stellar life by comparison to others, they still were nothing more than a sinner, and death eventually took their life. Oh, but friend, Jesus was not born of man. He was born of a virgin, conceived of the Holy Spirit of God. For you see, he was nothing less than God in the flesh. I want to give you the third thing. Not only was Jesus born of a virgin, not only was he conceived of the Holy Spirit, Jesus is the only begotten of God. There is none other. There is no other way to the Father. There's no other way to heaven. The Bible tells us that this is the record that God hath given of his Son. And he tells us in 1 John, there is no way to heaven other than through the person of God's Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in John chapter 1 and verse number 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John chapter 1 verse number 18, the Bible says, no man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. John chapter 3 and verse number 18, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. 1 John 4 and verse number 9, in this was manifest the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. May I say tonight, salvation is not through works, our church membership, our baptismal waters. Salvation is not through paying penance or giving money to the church. Salvation is by grace through faith in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. The richest man can be saved by grace through faith in Christ. The poorest man can be saved by grace through faith in Christ. The one who lives in a mansion can be saved by grace through faith in the person of Jesus Christ. The one on Skid Row, homeless, living under a bridge in a town, can be saved by grace through faith in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten of the Father. You see, Jesus is not like other men. Jesus was born of a virgin, conceived of the Holy Spirit, was the only begotten of the Father. The Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 5, and I love these words, he that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself, hath believed. He that believeth not hath made God a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God hath given unto us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. of God. I tell you what else I want you to know, and what I'd want the world to know about Jesus, in that he was different. He was born of a virgin, conceived of the Holy Spirit, the only begotten Son of God. Number four, Jesus lived a sinless life. Now, don't you know that the wisest men, the men of wit and wisdom of his day, they followed him in every day and every night. They listened to every word. They watched every behavior. They watched everything he did to see if they could find a fault, a sin in him. Pilate declared to the people, he said, "I find no fault in him." May I say, there was no fault to find. Now, if someone followed us every day, it probably wouldn't take a week for them to point out, this man is a sinner. This man is flesh, and he is a sinner. Oh, but you'd never find anything about Jesus that you could convict him of being a sinner. Here's what the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2. "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to know that judgment to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed." The Bible says, and I love this verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 21, "For hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Hey, we ought to sing about it. We ought to shout about it. We ought to preach about it. We ought to tell the world about it. Jesus is not just a good man, not just a great man, not just a prophet and a preacher man. Oh, Jesus was the very sinless Son of God. I love those words as old John the Baptist was preaching, and he was telling them about the Lamb of God that would take away the sin of the world. And as Jesus made his way down to hear that great preacher, in fact, the greatest that ever wore shoe leather, John saw Jesus coming, and he declared to the people, "Behold, the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world." I preach to you tonight, brethren, I preach to you tonight, Jesus, the Savior of the world. Then I want you to know it is that Jesus, born of a virgin, conceived of the Holy Spirit, lived a sinless life, lived among sinful men with no sin. Jesus died on the cross and arose from the grave. He shed his blood for the justification of our salvation. The Bible says this, 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 3, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which also I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scripture." No, I'm not exaggerating. No, I'm not telling you a lie, a fairy tale, or a fable. Jesus was placed in that grave. But dear friend, just as the prophets had said would happen, just as was recorded in the Word of God, after those 3 days, up from the grave he arose. You say, did he really die? Oh yes, he died. He was crucified on the cross of Calvary. He laid down his life for our sin. He laid down his life for our justification. Ah, but dear friend, after 3 days and nights, he arose from the grave. And dear friend, he walked and he lived among men. He was seen of thousands. He was seen many days after his resurrection, until we get to the book of Acts in chapter 1, and Jesus ascends to heaven. He goes back to the Father, and those angels said, "Why stand you here gazing? This same Jesus that you've seen go shall so come in like manner." That was the purpose Jesus came to earth. He came to die on the cross for your sin and for mine. Oh, but that's not all. I want to give you one last thing. This same Jesus is coming again. I believe that we're living in the days of his return. Without a doubt, I believe Christ could return tonight. I believe the sounding of the trumpet could happen at any moment now. I love those words, and I quoted just a part of a verse a while ago, but I read to you Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse number 7, and he said it, and he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which said unto them, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Dear friend, Jesus is coming again. It could be today. Are you ready to meet him? Have you received Christ as your personal Savior? Have you prayed and told Christ you're a sinner and you accept his payment for your sin? If you have not, today is the day of salvation. Now is the time. Call on him today.
Those folks who say that God is dead must see through vision dim by vain desires and worldly sins that God is dead to them. But my eyes searched, as did my soul, till I could plainly see his crowning glory all around. Now God's not dead to me. He lives in purple mountain tops and valleys so serene. I hear him in a robin song. He lives in great majestic pines that reach the clouds above. He's in the smile of a little child. Oh, truly God is love. The beauty of a blushing rose, his gracious touch has shown. And his hand, the velvet sky, with tiny gems was strewn. A thousand ways his loving touch displays the works of art. He has a dwelling place with me. He lives within my heart. Majestic pines that reach the clouds above. He's in the smile of a little child. Oh, truly God is love. He's in the smile of a little child. Oh, truly God.